Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For 10 bucks a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&A. So head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. If you like this podcast, don't forget to follow me on social media. Find me on Twitter, now X, at Brion McClanahan, also on Facebook, at Brion McClanahan, and on YouTube, where you can watch the podcast, at Brion McClanahan. It's a great time. I'd love to see you there. How do the Democrats plan to have the federal government influence the election in 2024? Well, this executive order might be a clue. I'll talk about it on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. Well, the election season is really heating up. We know who the nominees are going to be for the Democrats and Republicans. We've got RFK Jr. declaring an independent candidacy and picking a dope for a vice presidential candidate, which we knew was going to happen. But we had a major news event, actually in March of 2021, that hasn't gotten a whole lot of attention from the media. And in fact, it might be a way the Biden administration is seeking to circumvent all state election laws. In fact, they're being pretty clandestine about it. And it's an executive order that can completely undermine the powers of the states over elections. It's a big deal, but again, why would the media be silent? Well, because they want it to work. Now, it doesn't say that, and he would claim it doesn't do that. But the executive order is pretty clear. Congress won't pass the legislation I want, so I'm just going to do it with my pen and my phone. Now remember, this is how Barack Obama said he would legislate when the Republicans began blocking all of his initiatives. This is what executive government does. And of course, the ultimate outcome is centralization of power. Now, Biden's going to frame this in a way that he says we're trying to avoid discrimination, right? We have people in America that can't vote, that don't have access to voting. And in fact, the executive order says all this nonsense at the beginning of it. They're making claims that we still live in the 1960s or the 1950s. And it all comes down to the fact that they want as many potentially fraudulent votes or voters voting as they can get. Now, they're also going to say that if you oppose this, then you're against democracy. You're against democracy if you oppose these kind of initiatives. Go out and register all these people, mail-in balloting, same-day registration, voter registration, all this stuff. No voter ID to vote. You're against democracy if you don't support these measures. I think that most people with common sense would say these are things that you probably shouldn't do if you want election integrity. And when you're talking about budgets and the trillions of dollars and the oversized impact the federal government can have on not just American life, but also the world, maybe we need to be pretty careful about how we have people voting in America. Now, since the middle of the 19th century, there has been an extreme push in America to expand suffrage as far as we can. And I'm going to tell you, this is by design because of this very simple reason. Those in power will expand suffrage. And then when those people generally that they expanded it to don't always go their way, they're going to try to find a new voting block to grab votes from. So in the 19th century, that first voting block was any white male over the age of 21. they reduced or removed all property qualifications for voting. This was done in virtually every state. And at that time, it was thought that these people would vote for a particular side of things, and they weren't going to vote for, maybe they wouldn't vote for the Whigs, or maybe they wouldn't vote for the Federalists, whatever it was. They're going to vote more for the Democratic Republicans. In fact, in New England, they worried about this, all these farmers out there voting. It didn't necessarily work out that way. A lot of these people would vote for Whigs or Democrats. I mean, the Whigs were able in 1840 to use all kinds of propaganda to get a lot of people voting for them. So, you expand it there. Then you add the 13th Amendment, the 14th Amendment, and 15th Amendment. Most importantly, the 15th Amendment, which of course would allow former male slaves, freedmen, the ability to vote. So now you've expanded the voting population. And of course, the Republican Party loved this because this meant that they could win elections in the South. They disfranchised one group of people, former Confederate soldiers, so they disfranchised a large block of the white Southern voting population. They enfranchised former slaves, male former slaves, ensuring that they would win these elections in the South. It was, I mean, open. It was blatant what they were doing here. Well, women were pretty upset about this. And even though black Southerners were a loyal voting bloc, there was some rumbling that this may not hold long term. You had people like Hiram Rhodes Revels come out and say, well, the Republican Party has used us, so maybe there was a little bit of anxiousness about former slaves voting Republican all the time. So then what you do is you give the vote to women, and women are going to be loyal Republican voters. At least it was thought, and they were for a time, right? They vote Republican, but I mean, not all women did. I had to pull the numbers, but women generally voted for the Republicans, at least early on. Republicans were the dominant in the states where they were voting, right? Not the 19th Amendment, but this is before the 19th Amendment. So you start expanding out to the states. Then you get the 19th Amendment. And women come in to power, or at least have access to power. And at that point, when you get the 19th Amendment, you see more Democrats, women voting Democrat. And so now you have another voting block of people that are going to go your way if you want to expand federal power. Now, the key to all this, of course, was wanting to expand the power of the government. And then when that doesn't work any longer, then you lower the voting age to 18. Now there's talk about lowering it to 16. Allowing people who aren't even in the United States legally to vote. Expanding out the quote-unquote right to vote to people who have lost it because they're felons. This is going on in some states. So the whole key to this is Democrats are searching for voters. They want to ensure that they're going to maintain a numerical superiority and that they're going to win elections. That's the whole point. There's no altruism here. Well, we just want people to have their voice heard. I can almost guarantee you that this executive order and the voter outreach that Joe Biden is calling to spend tremendous amounts of federal dollars on is not going into affluent areas and trying to get people to vote. It's not doing it. It's going to go into places where they think they have voting blocks, and they think those people are going to vote Democrat, and they've got money to burn, which is important. Because is there going to be some kind of corruption going on here? Who knows? How is this going to be monitored? How is there any oversight? Well, the Biden administration is going to have oversight. Do you trust them? Do you trust the Biden administration to have oversight of any of this stuff? Is there a watchdog going around saying, well, you can't spend money on this. You can't do that. You can't stuff this money in people's pockets to vote. You can't ballot harvest. You can't do these things. You can't register felons. There isn't any oversight, and the states are perhaps being forced into this and spending money they don't want to through federal coercion. Hey, you want your K-12 money from the Department of Education? Make sure you get these high schoolers registered to vote. Colleges, your community college, universities, which of course, these are large blocks of Democrat voters. You want to get all your federal student aid? Make sure you're registering people to vote. You can see it. They have to do Get out the vote drives and initiatives. Make sure you're doing this, because if you don't do that, we'll withhold federal funds. You see, it's the hammer. It's the money. So what they're doing is bribing people to do this stuff. Now, again, by saying this, McClanahan, you sound like you're against people voting. No. But I am certain that this is not constitutional. Federal get-out-the-vote initiatives, particularly coming from the executive branch, are unconstitutional. There's nothing in the Constitution that allows Joe Biden to be the campaigner-in-chief. But that's what he's doing. I mean, look, the State of the Union address was a campaign speech. There's nothing in the federal Constitution, the U.S. Constitution, that allows the federal government to essentially control state elections, except for the amendments I talked about, and ensuring that the states actually hold federal elections or an election year. I mean, that's, they can do that. But there isn't a whole lot of federal control over these things. The states have a lot of it. Now, this goes back to the 14th Amendment issue again. I've talked about this several times on the show, how the federal government was interested in the 14th Amendment trying to bar Trump in Colorado. And the argument of the Democrats in that case was that the states had wide range of powers on these things and they could do this stuff. Now, does a state have control of ballots, meaning that who can go on the ballot? Do they control that or not? It's a big question. They started doing it after the war. Why? Because they wanted to ensure that only the people that they wanted on the ballot were on the ballot. Namely, the Republican Party. They wanted to keep their opponents off the ballot. You see, when you get the state involved in these kind of elections, at any level, doesn't matter if it's the United States, the central authority, which they think they're a state, or the states themselves, you have issues with this. So you should, as if we really believed in a situation where we can have real democracy, quote unquote, you should be able to put anybody you want on the ballot as long as they're qualified according to age. I mean, there is no restriction on race or sex or anything else, so it's age now. As long as they're not a felon, right? As long as you're eligible to participate in the electorate, right? If they can vote, they should be eligible for office as long as there's no age requirement for the office. So as long as they're over 35 for president, you know, 30 for Senate, 25 for House of Representatives, in federal elections, they should be able to be on the ballot. Doesn't matter who they are. If they are a qualified elector in the state where they reside, they should be able to be on the ballot. The state should not control that. Say, well, we're only going to have these people. They have to win a nomination. They don't have to do any of that. This is where you have someone like RFK Jr. searching for ballot access in states. He should be on the ballot because he's declared a candidacy. I mean, that's fine. He's going to spend money and he's going to do what he wants to do. And he should be there, whether you want him on there or not. But I want to get into this piece because it brings up some really interesting things, a little bit of, some shady things perhaps going on in some of this. So the headline, this is at the Epoch Times, the headline is, behind massive mail-in ballot push is a little notice executive order. A federal effort to register voters using the government's vast reach, including throughout the U.S. prison system, is raising concerns from critics who have said it won't benefit Democrats and Republicans equally. It won't benefit Republicans at all. First of all, in most states, there are restrictions on felons voting. Now, in some states, it's absolute. One of the states, of course, is Mississippi. Once you're a felon, you can't vote. You're permanently barred from voting. Once you're a convicted felon, you can never vote again. And if the federal government is going in and trying to register voters in the state of Mississippi who are felons, well, that would be illegal now, wouldn't it? But this is the accusation being made now. It's an accusation. Or at least they're looking into it. I don't know. It's an accusation. It's also the case in Alabama and some other states too. Once you're a felon, you can't vote. Now, in some states, once you've served your time and you've gone through parole, and in some cases, probation, you can vote. But it's a long process. Some states are trying to make it to where, like California, you can vote even when you're in jail. Now, imagine that. Do you think, I mean, I know California's got a bunch of lunatics out there, but any normal person, why would you want someone in jail to be able to vote? I mean, they're in jail. What's going on here? We know that by expanding the government payroll, you've created a whole lot of loyal voters. As Hamilton pointed this out. You know what we want to do? We want to make sure that we expand assistance to these former continental soldiers so they're going to vote for us. That was the point. You get loyal people to the central government. When you put them on the payroll, they're going to vote generally, not all the times, but I think it's in the 90th percentage. These people are going to vote for those who are going to expand out federal power because it gives them more money and more power. If you really want to talk about who should vote and who shouldn't vote, should you be able to vote for your salary? Is that something that should happen? Or once you become a government employee, should you lose your ability to vote in those elections because you're a government employee? I mean, should we have that conversation? You can't vote for more money for yourself. If you're on some type of assistance for the government, should you lose your ability to vote? Now, what is that going to do if we actually follow that down the rabbit hole? You've got so many people dependent on federal dollars now that you would have a very small electorate. I mean, because you would eliminate anyone on any kind of federal assistance, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. You would eliminate people on with welfare, any of that. You would eliminate people with government jobs. You're talking 2 million people and perhaps even their family members who are also there. So now you, let's say they're all married. So now you're looking at 4 million people. Soldiers, should they be able to vote? Maybe they would have more of a say than others because at least in their case, I mean, they could be killed for their government job. You know, so maybe people that are in those kind of, you know, dangerous government jobs, they should be able to have access to voting, security type jobs, maybe. But I mean, this is another question to have. Should these people be able to vote? I'm just throwing these things. What about a test, some type of test? No. Because that would be a problem. In fact, Joe Biden says it in section one of the executive order. Let me get into peace and then I'll get to the executive order. Mississippi Secretary of State Michael Watson wrote to U.S. Attorney General Merrick Garland, good luck, on March 6, alleging that agencies under the Attorney General's charge are attempting to register people to vote, including potentially ineligible felons, and to co-opt state and local officials into accomplishing this goal. Oh. Co-opt state and local officials. Now, that would be commandeering, and that's illegal. We know the Supreme Court has said this. You can't commandeer state and local officials to do federal work if they don't want to. But what they're going to do is dangle money out there and say, if you want your money, you're going to do it. The allegation relates to President Joe Biden's Executive Order 14091, which states, quote, the head of each agency shall evaluate ways in which the agency can, as appropriate and consistent with applicable law, promote voter registration and voter participation. Well, notice the out there, as appropriate and consistent with applicable law. Well, what does that mean? Are there ways around these things? So let's go to the executive order. And the first part of the executive order, purpose, brings up this idea that some people can't vote. The right to vote is the foundation of American democracy. The right to vote is a foundation of American democracy. I mean, if you want to have a statement that goes against American history, that would probably be it in terms of the foundation of American democracy. Free and fair elections that reflect the will of the American people must be protected and defended. But many Americans, especially people of color, confront significant obstacles to exercising that fundamental right. You see, this is the charge, that if you're a person of color in the United States, you cannot vote. Well, I mean, I'd like them to show people where they would walk into a voting place, if they've registered, where they can't vote. Somebody says, well, you can't vote. These obstacles include difficulties with voter registration, lack of election information, and barriers to access to at polling places. Lack of election information. Whose fault is that? Whose fault is that? And difficulties of voter registration. You know how easy it is to register to vote? It's simple. It's one of the easiest things you can do. You just have to be able to make condensation on glass and be over 18 years old and not a convicted felon, and you can vote as long as you're a citizen. Some cases, maybe not even that. Easy. For generations, black voters and other voters of color have faced discriminatory policies and other obstacles that disproportionately affect their communities. Again, this is LARPing. It's like we're living in the 1960s. These voters remain more likely to face long lines at the polls and are disproportionately burdened by voter identification laws and limited opportunities to vote by mail. The horror! Now, you see, what happened in Congress is interesting. The Congress tried to get the John Lewis Voting Rights Act passed. And the John Lewis Voting Rights Act would essentially made voter ID illegal. Now, of course, that would have been a real question. Can they even do that? Would have made it illegal. It would have made it to where voting by mail was basically a right. I mean, you can vote by mail anytime you want. So, in other words, it would have made it to where Democrats had permanent victories in elections. Now, there's very few places in the world, I think, the United States is one of the few that has massive vote-by-mail schemes. In fact, even in Georgia, Jimmy Carter, former President Jimmy Carter, was on a group charged with coming up with voter security or voting security. And one of the things they've thought that you should do is restrict mail-in voting. The only time you should be able to vote by mail is if you're absentee. And you have to get an absentee ballot. But if you can go vote in person, you should vote in person. Or perhaps if you're disabled and you can't get there, right? I mean, there are some things that maybe you should be able to get a mail-in ballot. If you're disabled, you're out of town, these kind of things. But there should be very few exceptions to the rule. You want to vote, you show up. And we have a voting day, an election day, not an election month or an election year. We shouldn't have all this early voting and everything else. You vote on the day. You go and you vote. And you have polling places open early and late. And that's what you do. And if you want to vote, you go show up and you wait in line if you have to. Lots of people do it. Waiting in line to vote somehow is denying someone the ability to vote. This is a weird accusation. Not being able to vote by mail is somehow denying someone the ability to vote. It's a strange, strange argument. This is what the Democrats have relied on. And this is now coming from an executive order. An executive order that you have to do these things. Now, whether that executive order is even constitutional is another question. I would say it's not. Limited access to language assistance remains a barrier for many voters. People with disabilities continue to face barriers to voting and are denied legally required accommodations in exercising their fundamental rights and the ability to vote privately and independently. Members of our military serving overseas, as well as other American citizens living abroad, also face challenges to exercising their fundamental right to vote. The Constitution and laws of the United States prohibit racial discrimination and protect the right to vote. Well, who's saying that any of this is racial? I mean, look, what it says is that if you can't deny someone the ability to vote if because of their race. Now, is there anything explicitly saying that? You can't vote because of this. No. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 and other federal assist statutes implement those protections and assign the federal government a key role in remedying disenfranchisement and unequal access to polls. So see, there it is. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 gives the federal government oversight over state elections. Now the Supreme Court has come in and said, we're going a little too far now. If you believe in the Supreme Court again. But This is the issue. Now, the Voting Rights Act of 1965 is based on the 15th Amendment. And it does say Congress can pass appropriate legislation ensuring that people who are not denied the vote because of their race. Now, you show me in this where people are being denied the ability to vote because of their race. If you have to show a voter ID, can anybody get a voter ID? Of course. In fact, there was a video, I think it was Walk Don't Run Productions or Run Don't Walk Productions, whatever it is, one of those two things, where he went through the Georgia law that the state of Georgia, or sorry, Major League Baseball removed the All-Star game from Atlanta because of this law. It was voter suppression, that's the term they used. And they went through all the ways that you could prove who you are. And anybody, again, if you can make condensation on glass and you're a citizen over 18, you could have proved it very easily. It's simple, but yet it's voter suppression because you can't just do whatever you want. It's ridiculous. In passing the National Voter Registration Act of 1993, the Congress found that it is the duty of federal, state, and local governments to promote the exercise of that fundamental right to vote. Executive departments and agencies should partner with state, local, tribal, and territorial election officials to protect and promote the exercise of the right to vote, eliminate discrimination and other barriers to voting, and expand access to voter registration and accurate election information. It is our duty to ensure that registering to vote and the act of voting be made simple and easy for all those eligible to do so. Again, this is the federal, overreach and meddling in state elections. They can say it's legal because of this legislation and that legislation, because we got the 15th Amendment broadly interpreted, but really is it? The 15th Amendment was designed to ensure that formerly, you cannot deny someone the right to vote based on the race. All the things they list there, that's not voter suppression. That's what they would say it is. Back to the story. Among other things, this order has forced U.S. Marshals to modify more than 900 contracts with prisons and jails to provide voter registration documents and facilitate mail-in voting for inmates, Mr. Watson wrote. You can't do that in Mississippi. If you're a felon, you can't vote. We have worked extremely hard to restore the confidence of Mississippi voters in our election process, Mr. Watson told the Epoch Times. To have the Biden administration and the DOJ purposely undermine these efforts and jeopardize the integrity of Mississippi's elections is unacceptable. It's illegal if they're going in and trying to get inmates to vote. In Mississippi, it's illegal. Now, Biden would say, whoa, wait a second here. We said consistent with the law. We're not going to do anything illegal. The work by the Department of Justice to register voters in prisons, critics say, is just the tip of the iceberg. Other agencies, including the Department of Education, the Department of Agriculture, the Department of Health and Human Services, and the Department of Housing and Urban Development, are also carrying out campaigns to sign up new voters. On February 26, President Kamala Harris lauded a federal plan to use work-study grants to pay students to register voters. This is what we need to be doing. You see, this is the federal dollars in education. In addition, President Biden's executive order directed federal agencies to select approved nonpartisan third-party organizations, approved, and state officials to provide voter registration services on agency premises. President Biden's executive order was called visionary by Sherwood and Cherry, a former staff attorney in the American Civil Liberties Union Voting Rights Project, who said, quote, "In a democracy, governments at all levels should be doing everything they can to help eligible people register to vote." However, critics say elections are under the purview of states, not the federal government. Exactly right. Elections are under the purview of the states. The states determine all this. The federal government does not. The Constitution is pretty clear about this. The reason it's such a big problem is that with the president, it's only one political party that's in power. Stuart Whitson, legal director of the Foundation for Government Accountability, a conservative think tank, told the Epoch Times. If you allow the president to be the one who decides where all these massive resources are channeled, that's problematic, he said. And this is why the founders gave election authority to the states and not the federal executive. The plan has been called Biden bucks by some of its detractors, referencing the injection into state election programs of $400 million in 2020 from Facebook co-founder Mark Zuckerberg, dubbed Zuckerbucks. This is Zuckerbucks on steroids because instead of $400 million, it's unlimited funding and resources and the reach of the federal government and all its offices located across the country, Mr. Whitson said. Previous efforts to federalize elections through Congress have failed. In 2022, Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer attempted to eradicate the legislative filibuster in order to pass H.R. 5746, the Freedom to Vote John R. Lewis Act, which would have given the federal government authority over parts of state election systems, expanded voting by mail, and eliminated security protocols such as requiring voter identification. Democrats claimed the bill was necessary to fight voter suppression. President Biden's executive order includes a directive for federal agencies to find ways to distribute, quote, vote-by-mail ballot application forms, as well as assist applicants in completing the application in a manner consistent with all relevant state laws. Again, we've got issues here. Biden is, there's an out here. Well, we're just doing it. We're following the state laws. But what's the real key? And of course, with the Department of Justice controlling which approved agencies get to do this, are they going to improve agencies that would expand, say, perhaps access to ballots for Republicans? I mean, they'd say, of course we're going to do that. We want Republicans voting too. No, they don't. No, they don't. What they really want is getting more of their people voting and, of course, using federal dollars to do this. Since the president signed Executive Order 14091, a number of attempts have been made to obtain information about how federal agencies will implement it, particularly which private organizations it has selected to work out of federal offices alongside government officials. Federal departments refuse to release this information and request for follow-up with Freedom of Information filings and subsequently by lawsuits. However, the Biden administration continues to defy the requests. Now, why would they do that? Why would they not be open about this? I mean, if there's nothing illegal going on here, or nothing scandalous or maybe inflammatory, anything, why would they deny Freedom of Information Act requests? Why would they do it? Why would they stonewall groups looking to, well, where are these dollars going? The level of corruption here is tremendous. I mean, anytime you have this situation, anytime the government stonewalls here, you have to question what's going on. Of course we know. Once they start doing that, we know they're doing things that are nefarious. We know they're doing things that aren't necessarily on the up and up. In July 2021, the FGA filed a Freedom of Information Act request regarding President Biden's voting access plan. The group sought information about what federal agencies were doing to implement the plan, as well as records from planning and strategy meetings among President Biden's staff, federal agencies, and the architects of Executive Order 14091. These documents and any other context will be handed over much more quickly, Mr. Whitson said. So this indicates to us that there's something there the Biden administration really does not care to share because they've withheld it for nearly 3 years. The American First Legal Foundation, other plaintiff in a Freedom of Information Act suit, characterized Executive Order 14019 as the president's unprecedented effort to deploy federal agencies in support of partisan voting operations and fortify politically aligned private organizations working to circumvent state election integrity laws. Exactly right. More than 2 years later, court battles over the information requests are ongoing. The administration has brought the White House counsel and the Department of Justice to fight the requests. I'm sorry, did I say this? This is from 2021, this executive order. This has been going on now for a couple of years, 3 years now. Prominent among the many federal agencies carrying out the executive order is the Department of Health and Human Services, which announced in 2022 that federal health centers across the nation now have the discretion to participate in activities, including voter registration, that are outside of the scope of core department activities. Such voter registration activities may include making available voter registration materials to patients, encouraging patients to register to vote, assisting patients with completing registration forms, sending completed forms to the election authorities, providing voter registration materials and waiting rooms, and allowing private, nonpartisan organizations to conduct on-site voter registration. Now, who's watching these people? Well, you know, if we're going to register, maybe you should be voting Democrat on this one. You know, these people, they're, you see, the Department of Education sent a letter to universities directing them to use federal work-study funds to support voter registration activities. The letter states, quote, if a student is employed directly by a post-secondary institution, the institution may compensate a student for employing voter registration activities that take place on or off campus. And this, of course, is going to get them more votes. The Department of Education in 2022 was threatening campuses that you better be registering students or you could lose your federal funds. Why? Because they get Pell Grants and student loans and all kinds of things. This is the issue. Two proponents of President Biden's Voting Access Plan, the ACLU, and a coalition of progressive groups called Strengthening Democracy produced their progress report on federal agency action to promote access to voting. The report details their assessment of how well 10 federal agencies are doing in implementing Executive Order 14019 and why they must do what they must do to improve. The report states that federal agencies should sign up new voters in the following ways. HHS should include voter registration and applications for health insurance under Obamacare. The VA should include voter registration for veterans who sign up for VA health benefits. Indian Health Services should help register patients using IHS facilities. The Education Department should include voter registration when students apply for federal student aid. And the Bureau of Prisons should work to register eligible convicts. Now, why would they target these groups? Hey, you're getting Obamacare, which is a federal program. You should sign up to vote so you can vote more Obamacare. Hey, you're getting these government assistance. You should sign up to vote so you can get more government assistance. That's the key. You're buying votes. The report praised the Treasury Department for its efforts targeting voter registration efforts at low-income clients of its voluntary tax preparation clinics. Hey, you like this government service you're getting? Sign up to vote so you can vote for more of this stuff. They're targeting welfare agencies. It's targeted voter registration, so you don't have to worry about turning out more Republican voters if you focus your efforts in places where the vast majority of voters are going to lean left, where they're going to get government assistance. That's the key. You see, they're getting government assistance, so those people would then vote for that particular group. And who are the people that are signing up? Although the Biden administration has refused to disclose which nonprofit organizations will partner with federal agencies, groups that support the effort include the ACLU, teachers unions, public employee unions, the Southern Poverty Law Center, the NAACP, the Black Voters Matter Fund, Public Citizen, Planned Parenthood, League of Women Voters, and the Sierra Club. I mean, just a litany there of conservative organizations, right? Those groups don't have any agenda. I mean, they're just good, straight-up nonpartisan organizations. I mean, do you believe that? So this thing, it's been around now for a couple of years, right? This executive order. And look at what's happened. Now, could this play a role in the 2024 election? Perhaps. Maybe. But they're going to use this term. They're trying to circumvent the legislative process and the states, by the way, to do what they need to do. Now, in November 2023, Representative Claudia Tenney from New York introduced an amendment to the 2024 Appropriations Bill that would prohibit federal agency funding from being used to implement Executive Order 14019. This is an appropriate and unconstitutional federalization of elections, Representative Tenney said at the time. It's true. America's civil service should be nonpartisan, and federal agencies should not be using taxpayer funds to actively engage in get-out-the-vote operations that have nothing to do with the agency's core missions. Representative Rosa DeLauria responded by saying President Biden's executive order recognizes there are too many obstacles to voting and is in place to expand access to voter registration and election information. An obstacle. Obstacles to voting. Yeah, I mean, you show up to vote and people are turning. None of that's going on. People can vote if you want to vote. There's no obstacles to voting. If you want to vote, you go vote. The amendment passed by a voice vote. The bill is currently stalled in Congress. Simultaneously, a group of 24 Republican legislators in Pennsylvania have filed a federal complaint against President Joe Biden, Governor Josh Shapiro, and representatives of the Pennsylvania Department of State, saying that they have usurped the authority of the legislature by changing voter registration and election rules. Their complaint in U.S. District Court for the Middle District of Pennsylvania asked a judge to declare these three actions unconstitutional. a voter registration executive order made by President Biden, a voter registration action by Mr. Shapiro, and some Department of State directives. They also request that the judge issue an order prohibiting the president, the governor, and state executives from making future changes to the elections process in Pennsylvania without following the legislative process. Well, that would be a good idea. Now, this is important going into 2024. It's all about power. Anytime they say, we're just trying to expand voting and all the good of things. No, they want power. That's the key. That's the key. All right. See you next time with the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.